Hello and welcome to Fresh Start, whatever day it is for you. If you did not perform as well as you wanted to on that first lecture exam, no harm has been done. Do not forget that your lowest exam grade can be replaced by your final exam if it helps you. So we're going to start our second unit. We're continuing our discussion about the cardiovascular system. We're going to do this in two parts. We're going to talk about blood vessel structures, so the arteries, arterioles, capillaries, venules, and veins. And then I'm going to split it up, and when we come back, we will talk about blood pressure. So hope you're having a great day. Let's just get this done. All right, so just review basic blood flow, leaving the heart, and we're typically talking about that left side of the heart when we talk about systemic, or we're talking about the pulmonary circulation, we're talking about the right side of the heart. But it's always going to go, arteries go away from the heart, and then when they get smaller, they're arterioles. And then our smallest vessels are the capillaries, that's our exchange vessels. And then the return trip, we have small little veins, so we call them venules. And then we have veins, and then we return to the heart. So that's just basic blood flow. In pictures, when you see red, that means it's oxygenated. It does not always mean it's an artery, because remember that pulmonary circuit going to the lungs is flipped. The pulmonary arteries are carrying deoxygenated blood, and the pulmonary veins return oxygenated blood to that left side of the heart. Okay, so sit back, relax. This is a great video. It's kind of going to introduce all the blood vessels and kind of where we're going in this episode.
The vascular system is made up of arteries, arterioles, capillaries, venules, and veins. This system can be thought of as a transportation or highway system. These roads provide unhindered flow of life-sustaining fluid and also rid waste from the body. Arteries, which always pump blood away from the heart, and veins, which always return blood to the heart, are similar in that they provide the roadways. Like roadways have different speed limits, weight limits, and traffic to deal with, the vascular system also has its own set of conditions to deal with. Arteries are like freeways offering fast, one-way traffic moving away from the heart. Arterioles act like off-ramps from the arteries to the capillary beds. Capillaries are like neighborhood roads. This is where the loading of nutrients to the cell and unloading of waste from the cell occurs. Venules act like on-ramps from the capillary beds to the veins. Veins are also like freeways, but since they contain 60% of the total blood volume, it's more like slow-moving heavy traffic leading back to the heart. Arteries and veins are each made up of three tunics, or coats. The outside layer, tunica externa, the inside layer, tunica intima, and the middle layer, tunica media. In this video, I will only talk about the tunica media. The tunica media is the middle layer of the blood vessel. It is the muscle layer that allows for the vessel to constrict. It also contains elastin, which allows the vessel to stretch and rebound like a rubber band. In the arteries, the tunica media is much thicker due to the forces generated by the heart. So when your blood pressure elevates in response to the demand of the body, the increase in pressure and volume can be tolerated. Otherwise, the arteries would just pop like an overfilled water balloon. Because there's no pulsating forces in the vein, there's no need for as much elastin or muscle in them. Hence, the tunica media is much thinner in veins. More about arteries. Remember, arteries carry blood away, and both begin with the letter A. If you've ever felt a pulse, that is an artery. Only arteries pulsate. When you get your blood pressure checked, they are listening for the sound of the blood flowing through an artery. Because arteries are pressurized, if it is cut, a person could bleed out very quickly. Therefore, arteries need to be more protected and situated deeper in the body. When a blood vessel is cut, it is easy to tell if it was an artery or vein. Arteries will spurt pulsating blood, as compared to a vein where the blood just flows. Now moving on to veins. Veins are generally visible just below the skin. One reason for that is to regulate body temperature. Another special feature found in veins are valves. Proof that veins have valves can be seen in those people who have those nice large veins in their arms or hands. you can actually see the valve working by occluding the blood flow, then milking the blood out while keeping the vein occluded. Where the blood stops, that's where the valve is. Now when you let go of the occluded vessel, you will see blood return. One way to tell the difference between a vein and an artery is if you can see the blood vessel, it's most likely a vein. If you can feel the blood vessel pulsate, it's an artery. So what's the importance of having valves in your veins? Let's look at someone sleeping. The body's laying flat, blood flows back to the heart evenly, and you can see there's not much need for those valves. Now let's remove those valves, and you'll see the blood continues to flow. So why do we need these valves? First, let's look at a container of water laying flat, and if you stand it upright, the fluid will fall to the bottom due to gravity. The same thing would happen in the body if we didn't have these valves. Without those valves, blood will flow in the direction of gravity, meaning that when you stand upright, the blood will all pull in your lower legs. Not only would that make it harder to walk, but there's a bigger issue. Now that the fluid has drained from the veins will collapse on themselves, meaning no blood is returning to the heart, and without blood flow, the heart can't beat. In fact, all organs rely on continuous blood flow. Without that continuous blood flow, death follows. Now that we know why we need these valves, let's put them back and bring life back. In closing, the vascular system is just a transportation network of tunnels throughout the body.
I hope you enjoyed that. That is just a fabulous introduction. I've written down some of those basics that he discussed. So we're going to go through the different types of vessels. And I just want you to keep in mind that the structure and the size between these different vessels, because, you know, we give them names so we can study them, it's going to be gradually changing between the types. So structure is always going to suit function, just like they said in the video. And then two, another thing is that vasculature varies in the individual. So we have some major arteries, we have some major veins, but then the other ones, especially veins, they get kind of wandering, and so they're going to be variable in different people. So just kind of keep that in mind. Okay, so I've given you a 2-page study sheet for this chapter. I highly suggest you print the study sheet. I know it's difficult for some of you to print, but if you can print it out, they've done studies that there's actual better memory retention when a person is reading something off of paper. I don't know if there's something about our brains that go, you know, I have it on my phone or I have it on my tablet. I don't really need to pay attention to this. They don't really know what it is, but if reading off of paper is better for memory retention. And so I put a whole lot of meat in this picture. And so we're just going to kind of go through this one today, and then the other side we'll do in the next episode. But just a little food for thought. There's a lot of questions on your next exam from that study sheet. Okay, so just like the video said, there's three tunics or coats. The open space in a blood vessel is called the lumen. This inner coat is called the tunica intima. It is intimate with the blood. And the purpose of the tunica intima is just to provide a smooth surface for blood flow. This tunica intima is going to be continuous with that endocardium that we talked about. It's just endothelium. It is simple squamous on a thin basement membrane. Remember, too, when vessels are healthy, meaning not having plaque buildup, they secrete anticoagulants, so those prostacyclin and nitric oxide, so we do not get inappropriate blood clotting. That middle layer is called the tunica media, and it is made up of smooth muscle and elastic tissue. The amount of elastic is going to vary based on the amount of pressure that vessel is under. It is a very important layer, which is why that's the only layer he talked about. Not saying that other ones don't matter, but these are the ones that are going to be involved in vasoconstriction. So these are circular, so think when they constrict, they're going to close that lumen. So kind of like a hoodie string around your face. You can just pull that string and it would close up around your face, so vasoconstriction. And then when it's wide open, then it's vasodilation. So when we use these terms, vasoconstriction, vasodilation, we are talking about those vessels that go away, so those afferent vessels, the arteries, and the arterioles. The veins, however, they can constrict as well. They don't have a thick tunica media, but we also get venoconstriction in the veins and the venules. That outermost layer is called a tunica externa, so think external. The other old-timey name is adventitia. It is an outer binding layer, so it's going to be connective tissue. It's going to connect that vessel to the structures around it, so it's going to have collagen, elastin, fibers. It's going to give protection. It's going to reinforce that vessel. Also, in the larger vessel, we have something called the vasa vasorum, which means vessel of the vessel. Some of those large arteries and veins, so think your aorta, your vena cava, they actually have their own little blood supply. I will show you in the next slide. Also, this is going to be, these vessels are controlled by the autonomic nervous system. So the nerves going to that vessel will also be traveling in that outer tunica externa, so nervi visorum. And they're going to control that smooth muscle, that tunica media. The autonomic nervous system, it is only the sympathetic nervous system that's talking to almost all of the blood vessels. There's one exception when we go to talk about reproduction. So this is a cross-section through the aorta, and it's only 4x magnification. Your aorta is approximately the size of a garden hose. So I like to kind of give it in common things. So here it's showing you the tunica intima, just the endothelium. It's got a basement membrane. Then you have a whole bunch of tunica media, so a lot of that smooth muscle. This is that tunica externa, and it's showing you the vasa vasorum. So there's actually little blood vessels feeding that artery. And it's also in veins as well, so the very large veins. So in lab, and also just for understanding, you have to be able to visually tell the difference between an artery and a vein. And there's a couple things really clear that makes it very obvious. The walls of the artery, since they're under more pressure, are thicker. And that's because that really thick tunica media. And so this is a cross-section through an artery. Notice too the shape compared to a vein, it's also rounder. So this is a histological slide. Someone had to create it, so they had to do a cross section, do a really thin cut. Veins are collapsible, and we'll talk about why in a little bit. They're collapsible, so when you slice through a vein, notice it loses its round shape. So arteries have they're typically round in cross section because that muscle's kind of tough, so it keeps its shape. Veins have that thinner wall, and they have a larger lumen, so a larger open space. So it makes it kind of easy to tell between an artery and a vein. I don't think you're going to have any problem, but hey, let's see. Can you tell? Hopefully you got that right. All right, let's move on. So we have arteries, arterioles, capillaries, venules, and then veins. We are going to talk about all of these and the differences between them, but just want you to keep in mind there is going to be a gradual change between these vessel types. So the difference in structure of arteries and veins has to do with the pressure that that vessel is under. So this is showing here we're starting at the aorta, so coming off that left ventricle. When the heart contracts, so that's called systole, the pressure it generates in the aorta is about 120 millimeters of mercury. When the heart relaxes, the aorta is actually very stretchy. It's called an elastic artery. It's going to expand under that systolic pressure. But when the heart is resting, then we get recoil, and that's what's responsible for the diastolic pressure. But you can see that the arteries, like the aorta, like I said, the branches right off of the aorta are called elastic arteries. They're under a lot of pressure. And then as we go further away from the heart, look, we're losing pressure. Once we get to the arterioles, notice we no longer have a pulse pressure. So we don't feel the difference between systole when the heart contracts or diastole when the heart relaxes. By the way, I know, spoiler alert, that's where you get systolic pressure and the diastolic pressure numbers of blood pressure. That top number is the pressure under systole when the heart's contracting, and that bottom number is that pressure in the vessels when the heart's relaxing during diastole. But like I said, notice the arteries are under the greatest pressure, so they have to have the thickest walls. We go arteries, capillaries, that's our functional unit of the cardiovascular system. We have a little pressure, and now we need to make the return trip back to the heart. So think about the return trip from your big toe. We do not have a lot of pressure. We are down to about 10 to 15 millimeters of mercury to get back to the heart. So the veins are going to have those valves like that video talked about. We're going to talk about there's four ways that the veins use to get blood back to the heart because they are not a high pressure vessel. But all valves are always there to prevent backflow. So we're going to start off with arteries. Big thing, yep, arteries away from the heart. This is where you're going to take and feel a pulse because it's the only place that's close enough to the heart where you feel a systolic and diastolic. And pretty much we are talking about systemic all the time, but keep in mind, same thing happens in the pulmonary circuit, although the pulmonary circuit is much lower pressure. We'll talk about that at the end of episode 2. So we're just gonna go through the three type of arteries. So elastic arteries, muscular arteries. And when they get cute and little, we call them arterioles. And so we're just going to kind of go through those. So the largest arteries are called elastic arteries. And you can look right here. They're called elastic arteries because, oh, look, they have the most elastic tissue. So it just sort of makes sense. And like I said, these are going to be our pressure reservoirs. They are what's responsible for that pressure when the heart relaxes. So think about this elastic artery. Systole, it gets really, really big. And then diastole, then we get relaxation. And the elastic in those elastic arteries is responsible for that. We talk about vasoconstriction later when we talk about blood pressure. These are not something that we're going to be controlling blood pressure. These are way too big. But like I said, pressure reservoirs. That's the picture I was looking for. There we go. So this is just showing you we've got systolic pressure. When the left ventricle contracts, that stretches those elastic arteries. They recoil during diastole, so we have the diastolic pressure. And so that's the function of those elastic arteries. Muscular arteries, hey, guess what? Where do you think they have the biggest, most tissue? Yep, they have the most smooth muscle tissue compared to the other ones. The other name for these are distributing arteries. These are the arteries that basically they are going to deliver blood to the particular organ. So in lab, on your lab list, all the ones that are named other than like the aorta and the brachiocephalic, the subclavians and those common iliacs, everything else is pretty much going to be a muscular artery. So they have that thick tunica media with more smooth muscle and less elastic than those elastic arteries. So got elastic arteries, muscular arteries, and then we go to arterioles. So now look at the size. So we've gone from centimeters to millimeters, and now we're measuring in micrometers. So very, very small. So this is going to be gradual, and so the arterioles feed into the capillary beds. So that layer of muscle, so that tunica media, that is going to become then inconsistent. So you can see I've given you this picture. It's not going to be continuous like it was in the arteries. What these do, though, these smooth muscle bands are very important because they are going to be very active in vasoconstriction and vasodilation to control our blood pressure. We're going to talk about blood pressure and something called mean arterial pressure. That's really going to be the one we're really concerned with clinically because that has to be above 60 or we're going to get organ failure. That's coming up, second episode. These are the vessels. They have what's called muscular tone. Just kind of tuck that away in your mind. That's coming up. Ah, never mind. It's coming up right now. All right. So the arterioles, remember, they are innervated strictly by sympathetic fibers. And so we are going to use vasoconstriction and vasodilation to control our blood pressure short term. And so this is showing you normal artery. They're always under some tension, so they're always partially constricted, which is why they call that vaso for vessel, motor, we're talking about muscles, and tone. So think about, you know, just you tone your muscles. So they're always somewhat constricted. When we need to raise our blood pressure, then through the autonomic control of sympathetic fibers, we can constrict, and that's gonna raise our blood pressure, so that's a constricted artery. If we want to lower our blood pressure, then those muscles would relax and we would get vasodilation. So this is going to be really, really important. That's how we basically, one of the ways we use to control our blood pressure short term. So also what's happening, notice, look, in the arterioles right here, we get this drop in pressure. And that's a good thing because now we're going to go into our capillary beds and this is where we're trying to get. The whole point of the cardiovascular system is its delivery of nutrients and oxygen, and it's a pickup of waste, carbon dioxide and nitrogenous waste. We're also delivering hormones and all those other things, but it is a delivery system. So we kind of want things to move slowly when we're in the capillaries. So yep, here we go. Capillaries, the functional unit of the cardiovascular system. Ta-da! Yep, exchange vessels. This word perfusion is an important word, is delivery of blood to the tissues themselves. We're going to talk about tissue perfusion, how that's going to be based on body needs. But the whole point, like I said, we're exchanging waste. We're going to pick up waste, carbon dioxide. We're going to give nutrients and oxygen. So that's kind of the point. So that low pressure allows time for that diffusion. It is simply just one cell thick. So it really only has that tunica intima. It fits single file red blood cells. We're also going to have pre, which means before, capillary. Sphincters are those circular muscles at the ends of the arterioles. And so that can, those sphincters can be open and we get tissue perfusion, or they can be closed and then those tissues would not receive blood at that moment. And so this is all going to be based on tissue needs and temperature. Yep, hold that thought too. So there's three different types of capillaries, and I've given them to you in order. So we are going to go from the least permeable to the most permeable, from the most common, I can't really say the least common, but from the most common is going to be the continuous. So once again, our goal is exchange, and so that's why it's so thin. So in a continuous capillary, what we have these small clefts between those endothelial cells for exchange. You're going to find these types of continuous capillaries in muscles and skin. When you talked about that blood-brain barrier, that was a continuous capillary. That was a special type. When we get pores, so now we're a little more permeable, that's called a fenestrated capillary. And so we have pores, so this just makes it a little easier for secretion and absorption. So in the small intestine, I know we haven't gotten there yet, but that's where we absorb all our nutrients. And so we are going to absorb those nutrients in the capillaries of the small intestine. Kidneys, their job is to filter blood and make urine. So they do a whole lot of secreting and absorbing. And most endocrine glands are going to have fenestrated capillaries. So when they release their hormones into the interstitial fluid, they just sort of have these little fenestrations to get into the bloodstream easily. The most permeable, and you can see these big open spaces, these are sinusoid capillaries, and you find these in bone marrow. Think about it. Bone marrow, we have those hemocytoblasts, so we need those blood cells, those new blood cells, to be able to get into circulation. The liver, too. There's going to be sinusoids there. The liver filters blood and detoxifies it for us. The spleen also filters blood and removes old red blood cells. And then the adrenal medulla has sinusoids. So when we have that emergency, we get that nervous system innervation. So through neural control, we get that release of epinephrine and norepinephrine, so adrenaline, noradrenaline. And we want that to get in the bloodstream as quickly as possible because we are in emergency. So continuous, clefts, fenestrated, pores, sinusoids, big open spaces, sinuses. So capillary beds. So when you see a picture like this, so true capillaries, there are 10 to 100 exchange vessels per capillary bed. There is no cell in your body that's more than a micrometer away from a capillary bed. So there is that branch. So we're over here on the arterial end. We have these pre-capillary sphincters that can be controlled. If tissue in a particular area, so right now, like I'm sitting down, I'm talking, my legs aren't doing a whole lot. So they aren't making a lot of ATP. They're not going through a lot of oxygen. So what can happen is if a tissue isn't going through metabolism, these sphincters are going to be closed. And then that tissue can be bypassed by a met arteriole. So this is just a vascular shunt from one side of the capillary bed to the venule on the other side. So a true capillary bed. And then this is called a met arteriole. And that's a vascular shunt. So these sphincters, I know you probably didn't know this, we don't have enough blood to be everywhere at once. And so these sphincters are going to be controlled through autoregulation based on those tissue needs. So how do they know? So when a tissue is active, the oxygen is going to be low because they're using it to make ATP. Carbon dioxide is our waste gas, so that's going to be high. And then we are acid makers. So all of these things just trigger the opening of these precapillary sphincters. And so then we get tissue perfusion, drop off of nutrients, oxygen, pickup of waste. The opposite is going to occur if nothing's happening. So like I said, right now I'm not really doing anything with my legs. So oxygen is high, carbon dioxide is low, it's not making a lot of acid. So those sphincters are going to be closed and the blood is going to travel through that bypass that met arteriole. There you go. So arterial venous anastomoses, we kind of talked about those. We know that we have that in the coronary circulation. This is really common at joints and the abdominal organs, the brain and the heart. You don't ever have that in the retina, kidneys, and spleen. I'm not really going to ask you that, but I'm just saying they're not everywhere. But there are places, think about joints, they bend, your abdominal organs, you need to have good perfusion, brain and heart. So there's just special places. We just have collateral routes to get from one side to the other. Like I said, you probably have more than one way to drive home or one way to get there. All right, so what's happening at the capillary?
At the arterial end of the capillary, the net filtration pressure is equal to the net hydrostatic pressure minus the net osmotic pressure. The net filtration pressure is 13 millimeters of mercury. This causes fluid to move from the capillary into the interstitial fluid. At the venous end of the capillary, the net filtration pressure is equal to the net hydrostatic pressure minus the net osmotic pressure. The net filtration pressure is minus 7 millimeters of mercury. This causes fluid to move from the interstitial fluid into the capillary. Approximately 9/10 of the fluid that leaves the capillary at its arterial end re-enters the capillary at the venous end. About 1/10 of the fluid passes into the lymphatic capillaries and returns to the bloodstream via the lymphatic system.
Okay, so like I said, capillaries are that functional unit, and it's really nice. So we get this drop-off on the arterial end and a pickup on the venous end. There we go. So this is just what that video showed, and I've kind of given you this picture, so think about it. The bigger force is always going to win, so we're only concerned with that net pressure. And so we get drop-off of nutrients and oxygen, so we get net flow out on that arterial side because the greatest pressure is hydrostatic pressure. And so I have that for your highest force on the arterial end. So the biggest thing is that hydrostatic pressure moving things out. And the hydrostatic pressure is gonna be comparable to blood pressure if you wanna think about it that way. On that venous end, we have those albumins, part of those plasma proteins that are gonna be pulling things back in. So the greatest force on that venous end is going to be osmotic pressure. And I put that on your study sheet, and yeah, you're probably gonna be asked that. But it's nice, we have drop off, we have pick up on the venous end, so that's nice. So notice the difference in pressure. All right, so we had a net flow out of 11 millimeters of mercury, and then we have a net flow in of 8 millimeters of mercury. Is that even?
No.
See, you're not here to talk to him. Kind of sucks. But anyway, all right. So nope, on the venous end, only about 85% of that fluid is going to be returned. And so our lymphatic system, we're going to talk about next chapter, that is kind of like our sewer system. So think about when we get too much rain, this picks up the excess water. It's going to be the lymphatic system that's going to return that remaining fluid from the interstitium back to the venous bloodstream. And we leave about 3 liters of a day out in that tissue fluid. So that is this part of the picture. So you're gonna see this picture again, I promise you. And so like I said, we have net flow out on the arterial end because of hydrostatic pressure. We've got osmotic pressure pulling things in on that venous end. And then we're gonna make our way back to the heart. So that excess fluid is just gonna find its way in that lymphatic system. They always draw it green. Lymph is not green, but that's just the color they picked. It's gonna get filtered along the way through lymph nodes, and then we're gonna return that excess fluid into the subclavian veins, and then it's gonna go back to the heart. And so it's just a great little system. All right, so we've gone through the capillaries. Now it's time for the return trip. So we have venules and veins, and then we have the superior inferior vena cava. So there's not a lot of pressure for that return trip. So we have change in structure. So notice here, our thickest layer is gonna be that tunica externa. We have very little smooth muscle. The walls are gonna be thin. That smooth muscle though is capable of constricting, so we will get venoconstriction. So thin walls are gonna be collapsible, which that's gonna be helpful in a minute. We have big lumens, so low resistance, and that thick tunica externa. So arteries are gonna be where you would take a pulse, where you take blood pressure, but it's gonna be the veins where you draw blood. Those veins serve as a blood reservoir. for up to about 60-65% of blood is always going to be in the veins when we are at rest. So those are important things to know about veins. So this is what I mean about blood reservoir. So this is showing you where blood flow is at rest. Normally, I said about 60% is going to be in the veins. And so this is showing a person at rest. So when someone's at rest, total blood flow is about 5,800 mils per minute, so 5.8 liters per minute. When someone is exercising, then notice we have a whole lot more blood being circulated. And so then we would get venoconstriction. So now some of this blood, it would be then shunted to the skeletal muscles. Oh, look, to the skin, because we want to dissipate heat. It's going to go to the heart. We get more blood going to the heart. Brain always gets its share. We kind of need that. Kind of need the big noodle. It's important. But then notice here, don't forget, when we're exercising, your body kind of sees it like an emergency, if you will. And so we're going to move blood away from the viscera. And that's another thing. Then it's going to go, like I said, to the skeletal muscles, to the heart, and to the lungs. So blood reservoir, veins. All right, so we have this low pressure. So there's going to be four ways that we are going to make sure that blood gets back to the heart. Number one, we have valves. And so we have these one-way valves. And think about it. They're going to be more abundant in limbs, but valves always prevent backflow. So how this is going to work, the walls are very thin and collapsible, so we're going to use what's called a skeletal muscle pump. And so that muscular tone in our limbs is always going to be distal to proximal, so that's always there even when you're not moving. But the more you move around, your skeletal muscles are going to contract. And so these veins, they're going to get compressed. It's sort of like the blood's going to get milked back to the heart from one section to the next. So that's called a muscular pump. So the more someone's moving, the better venous return, the more blood that's going to go back to the heart. We also have the respiratory pump, which we're going to watch a video in just a second. So those pressure changes in the abdominal thoracic cavity also helps move things towards the heart. Then two, those vessels are capable of constriction. So under sympathetic control, that too can help push the blood towards the heart. So valves, muscular pump, respiratory pump, venoconstriction are all necessary because we have very little pressure for that return trip.
Venous return is the flow of blood from the periphery back to the heart's right atrium. Blood from the upper body returns via the superior vena cava. Blood from the lower body returns via the inferior vena cava. The rate of venous return is determined by two factors, the pressure gradient between venous pressure and right atrial pressure, and venous resistance. A decrease in right atrial pressure leads to an increase in venous return, and vice versa. Breathing is one of the mechanisms that facilitate venous return. This is known as thoracic pump or respiratory pump. During inspiration, the diaphragm moves down, expanding the thoracic cavity, resulting in a decreased intrathoracic pressure and a subsequent expansion of the lungs. Part of this change in pressure is transmitted across the walls of the heart, lowering right atrial pressure and thus facilitating venous return. Another aspect of the diaphragmatic descent is the concomitant increase in abdominal pressure. As the inferior vena cava passes through both abdominal and thoracic cavities, an increase in abdominal pressure together with a decrease in thoracic pressure squeeze the blood upward toward the heart. On the other hand, left ventricular stroke volume is decreased during inspiration. This is because the expansion of the lungs causes pulmonary blood volume to increase and the blood flow from the lungs to the left atrium to decrease. During expiration, the diaphragm moves up. The pressure in the thoracic cavity reverses. Venous return decreases. Pulmonary blood vessels shrink, pumping more blood through the pulmonary veins into the left atrium. Stroke volume increases as a result. Thank you for watching.
Okay, so just recapping, there's four methods that the veins use to return blood to the heart. So we have valves, muscular pump, respiratory pump, venoconstriction. Thinking about the muscular pump and the respiratory pump, the more someone is moving, so someone's exercising, they're moving more. Also, they're going to have an increased rate and depth of breathing. All of that is going to facilitate moving blood back to the heart. And that's good because we are going to need more oxygen and more nutrients to then fuel that exercise. Okay, so what's the deal with varicose veins? So we already learned that veins are going to be superficial. They have these valves. So when people get varicose veins, the problem is that those valves become incompetent. And remember, an incompetent valve is not doing its job. And the one job of a valve is to prevent backflow. And so we just get these leaky valves, and then they're thin walls so they can bulge. And so that is what is a varicose vein. Other problems we can have structurally is something called an aneurysm. So an aneurysm is when the wall thins, and then because we're talking about arteries, they are under more pressure. So we get varicose veins, but we get aneurysms in arteries. And so they're going to balloon out. And I don't know, I always thought of like a tire that has that thin wall, and sometimes you get those bubbles and then they can burst. So that's exactly what happens. If the wall is thin, it's more prone to rupturing and cause massive bleeding and death. Commonplace is going to be the aorta or in the brain. So it's usually the elastic or the muscular arteries. With age, they're less able to withstand that force from the pulsating blood. But you can have aneurysms even young. Actually, my uncle, he was 18, he was a football player, in the middle of a workout, had a brain aneurysm. He lived through it, but it was pretty rough. But so anytime you have those thin walls, you can get an aneurysm. And so if someone has one, if it's been detected, then the walls will be measured. And then if need be, then that vessel can be corrected. Okay. So we did it. So we did this whole side. Oh, take a look. Look around it. Make sure that you see we have everything. So we talked about arteries. Those first arteries off, those are elastic arteries. So they provide that pressure during diastole. So those are our pressure reservoirs. At an artery, you're going to take pulse and blood pressure. Those muscular arteries, they are distributing arteries. They're going to deliver blood to the organs. They're active in vasoconstriction and dilation, but it's going to be these arterioles, these resistant vessels, that are going to control perfusion. So down here, perfusion, because of those precapillary sphincters, they're also going to regulate our systemic pressure. We'll talk about mean arterial pressure next episode. We talked about those three types of capillaries: continuous, fenestrated, sinusoidal. The continuous ones are the most common. We've got our hydrostatic pressure pushing things out on the arterial end. We get exchange occurring at the capillaries. So nutrients, oxygen drop off on the arterial end. We get pickup because of osmotic pressure moving things in on that venule side. So those venules, and then we have those veins. We are going to be returning our way to the heart. You're going to draw blood from a vein. Veins serve as blood reservoirs as well. You can get venoconstriction to release it. Very low pressure, thin walls, collapsible. Four methods. Yes, do you know those? Valves, muscular pump, respiratory pump, and venoconstriction. As always, if you have questions, ask me, but I'm going to send this out as a challenge to you. So I have a little Kahoot for review to make sure that you got all this. So I'll send that out through Remind. So if you are not on Remind, you need to make sure you get on so you get this. Hey, have an awesome day.